I'm in northern Queensland, thousands and thousands of kilometres away from Sydney, where I live, on this most beautiful, glorious, and it is a gorgeous beach. And it's just the most beautiful weather. It's autumn in Australia. I guess today might be 24, 25 degrees, not a lot of humidity. Just a great day to be alive and a great day to be in beautiful northern Queensland. And this particular tropical beach, it's somewhere between Cairns and Port Douglas. This beautiful beach is where I've come to share with you a very important message. Now, when I come here, my instinct is to go for a swim. It's warm, the beach is beautiful, the palm trees, the water, it looks very, very inviting. But there's a problem. In fact, there's two problems with the water here in northern Queensland. The first problem is this. That water, as inviting as it looks, is full of stingers. Now, stingers, if you get stung by one, you can end up in hospital. Apparently, they'll even kill you if you're not careful. And so if you go swimming in northern Queensland, you have to watch for stingers. But there's something bigger and far more sinister, and I think far more hostile than stingers lurking in that water. Crocodiles. And if there's something that brings fear into my heart, it's crocodiles. When I think of crocodiles, I think of 6, 7, 8 meter monsters that could swallow me, and I'd be just a snack as quickly as look at me. And I got to tell you that if the crocodile who lives in there came out of that water and started to head for me, I'd only do one thing, and I'd do it fast, I'd run. Now, I may not look like I can run, but if there was a crocodile coming out of that water at me, I would leave the producer, I would leave our timer, and I would leave our lighting man. I would run and I'd beat them all and I'd set a 100 meter record. Because I am scared of crocodiles. And my instinct when I see them would be to run, 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 run. You know something? Often when people, you listen to this, often when they first meet God, they have the same instinct as I do with crocodiles. And that is to run. And there's a reason for that, and I've seen it over and over and over in my ministry. When you first meet God, I mean for the very first time, and you see Him in his glory and in His power and in His purity and in His perfection, and then you look at yourself, it is extreme, because you see yourself with all your sin and all your guilt and all your shame and all your filthiness. And as you're looking at God and you see yourself perhaps for the first time for what you really are, your instinct is to run, 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 just like I'd run from a crocodile. But that doesn't have to be your instinct. And it's not what God wants you to do. I want to talk about this to you today, and I know that it's an important subject, and I know if your heart is open, that when you do meet God, if you have met God and your instinct is to run, if your heart is open and you hear this truth, God will bring it back to you and you won't run. You won't run from Him, you'll run to Him. And that's my prayer as we look at this very important topic today. Let's pray. Father in heaven, well, it's an awesome thing to first come in contact with You. It's also a sobering thing to see ourselves for what we really are. And the instinct of many of us when we first see You is to run. Lord, as we open the Bible and we look at this truth today, may we be drawn to You and not from You. May You encourage us, and may we see Your mercy and Your grace and Your incredible love to each of us is our prayer in Your name. Amen. Isn't this beach and isn't this place just beautiful? You know what? I would live up here. I would live up here, except I hear it is just so hot during the summer. I want to share with you today in this glorious place a glorious message. And it's found in Isaiah chapter 6. Now, you may not know it, but Isaiah was an Old Testament prophet. And when he wrote down this vision that he got from God, he wrote it down 2,000, listen to this, it's incredible, 2,740 years ago. Amazing. This is an old, ancient prophecy, but God gave this message to Isaiah for you. Isaiah chapter 6 and verse 1. And Isaiah says this, "In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord seated on a throne, high and exalted, and the train of his robe filled the temple." Now you might think, as you look at this program today, that this is a beautiful beach, and surely it is. But Isaiah was taken to a place far more glorious and far more beautiful, believe it or not, than this beach. He was taken straight into the throne room of God himself, and he was taken there for a reason. God wanted to show Isaiah that no matter how he felt, no matter where he'd been, no matter how deep was his sin, God wanted to tell Isaiah that he was in his throne room, that his arms were open wide, and that he wanted to be with him. And God wants to tell you through this passage of Scripture the same message today. No matter how you feel, no matter how deep you are in sin, no matter how much guilt and shame you've got in your life, no matter how you are traveling today, God wants you. God loves you. Nobody else may want you. Nobody else may love you. Nobody else may want to spend time with you, but God does. And that is the focus of this message today. God wants you. And he doesn't just want you a little bit. He wants you desperately. And the cry from his throne room that went out to Isaiah over 2,700 years ago, the cry for human companionship from the great God of heaven that went to Isaiah goes to you today. Let's get further into this. I tell you, it is an amazing Bible study. Isaiah chapter 6, verse 2. Above Isaiah were seraphs, their angels, each with six wings. With two wings they covered their faces, with two they covered their feet, and with two they were flying. And they were calling to one another, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. The whole earth is full of his glory." I find it interesting that these seraphs, these angels, these beings that have never felt or experienced sin, they don't know shame, they don't know guilt, they're some of the most pure and incidentally powerful beings in the entire universe. Isn't it interesting that here they are, they're in the throne room of God, they have their feet covered with one set of wings, they're flying with the others, and look at this, and it's telling. They are covering their eyes with their last set of wings. Not even these holy, pure, powerful beings can look at God in all his glory. Is it any wonder that when many of us first come to God, our first contact, when we first see him, when we first look at him, is it any wonder that our instinct is to run from him and to run as fast as we can? Even the angels can't look at God in his full glory. But there's good news. There's good news. Come with me in the Bible and I'll show you. This is Port Douglas. Beautiful place. When I think of Port Douglas, I think of Christopher Skase, millionaires, lots of money, luxury and holidays. And Port Douglas is indeed that. It's also as far as the tar road goes in Australia. You can't go much further by tar road than Port Douglas. And it's an interesting, vibrant, and I think probably if you get a chance, great place to come and have a holiday. And yes, it's beautiful. Now we've been talking about God. We've been talking about how people, when they come into the presence of God, one of the responses, in fact, probably the majority response people have is they want to run. And we've even looked at angels who are created beautiful and perfect, and even they, when they are in the presence of this awesome, powerful, this majestic God, they cover their faces with their wings. I remember probably my first year of ministry, I was doing a Bible study with a young man. And he was having what I call this allergic reaction to God. He wanted to come to God. He wanted to have an experience with God. He wanted to have a friendship with God. But when I would go to study with him, and you know, when you open the Bible, you come directly into the presence of God. And if you're living a life apart from God, and if perhaps you've never met him before, you are going to have usually a reaction, possibly against him. And every time I'd open the Bible and start to share with this young man, I'd see this allergic reaction, and that's what I call it, happen as he came into contact with God. Now, he'd had a rough life. He'd gone through a marriage breakup. He had been involved in immorality himself with a number of different women. He had been walking far from God. But when I opened the Bible and I began to share with him the mercy and the love of God, all he wanted to do was run. I want to tell you today, if you're feeling like that, it's a natural human reaction. But it's not the reaction God wants you to have. I'm on the beach here at Port Douglas, and behind me are the shark, the crocodile, and the stinger nets. This is the only place in Port Douglas and on the entire coast from Cairns upwards that I have seen that you can swim safely. And if you are within these nets, you are not going to be attacked by a crocodile, you are not going to be attacked by a shark, and you are not going to be stung by a stinger. The only safe place. I want to stress to you, the only safe place you can swim on this coast. And with God, you will find safety. You will have an allergic reaction to run. That is your sin which separates you from God. You will have a flight response when you first come into contact with God. Remember, that is natural. You are looking at yourself as a sinner. You are seeing your filth, and you are in the presence, like Isaiah was, of a holy God. But we need to do what Isaiah did. And if you do what Isaiah did, you're going to be all right. And more than that, you're going to get a walk. You're going to get a relationship with Jesus that will take you onto a mountain you have never been on. Give you peace. This is the way to go. So what does Isaiah do? Isaiah chapter 6 and verse 5, he's in the presence of God. The temple is shaking. The angels are covering their faces. He is absolutely awestruck. He is in the throne room of God. And this is his response. And his response is an example of what yours and my response must be. Isaiah 6 verse 5, "Woe to me," I cried. "I am ruined. For I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips, and my eyes have seen the King, the Lord Almighty." You seeing what Isaiah's done there? He's acknowledging his sin. He's acknowledging his guilt. He's acknowledging his filth. Here he is. He's standing in the presence of this great and this mighty, this pure and this perfect God. He can see his filth. He can see his uncleanliness. And he's saying, "God, I am dirty. I am filthy. I am a sinner." But did you see what he doesn't do? He doesn't run. He stays there. He doesn't run. And even though you want to, I'm imploring you, when you come into contact with God, when he comes to you, please don't run. You're in a safe place. God will not hurt you. This is the beginning of a new life for you. Don't run. God is there, and he's there to save you. We've come across the Daintree River by ferry. It costs $22 return for about a 100-metre ferry ride. And we're on the road to Cape Tribulation, so we're deep up north. And we came across this sign. I thought I just had to share with you what it says. It says, "Warning, crocodiles inhabit this area. Attacks may cause injury or death. Keep away from the water's edge and do not enter the water." Okay, I'll obey that. "Take extreme care when launching and retrieving boats. Do not clean fish or leave fish waste near the water's edge, and camp well away from the water." Yep, I'm going to do that. But what I'm interested in and really interested in seeing on this sign is it says Achtung. And do you know what says Achtung? Because German tourists keep getting eaten by crocodiles. This sign is a warning, and I've got a bit of German in me, so I'm going to take notice of that warning. But I'm going to go down to the river here where the crocodiles live, I'm going to get Matt, who is with us today, to watch out for crocodiles, and I'm going to share with you the next important segment of this great message of Jesus, who loves you even in your fear. We're at Cooper's Creek. We're on the way to Cape Tribulation. Sometimes when I come out to do programs like this into the great Australian outdoors, I can't help but be deeply impressed at the beauty of God's creation. And this is such a place. And I love it, except for the crocodiles, I love it. This is just so beautiful. If you ever get a chance, you need to come up here and have a look at what Australia has to offer. I want to take now this Bible study a little further. And I want to give you an illustration of a man that I think committed perhaps the most heinous, the deepest, one of the worst sins in all of Scripture, perhaps in the entire history of mankind. And I want to show you what, as this man came into contact with God, a man that, if ever there was a man, would have looked at himself and said, I'm the filthiest, the dirtiest, the greatest sinner of all. I want to show you what he did, because I think in what he did is an example of what you and I can do when we come to God and we feel our filth, when we feel our sins and we want to run. The man's name is David. And his story, and I'm just going to give it to you briefly, is an interesting one. His name is David. He's the second king of Israel. He lives thousands of years ago. He is all powerful and he sees a beautiful woman and he takes her and he sleeps with her. And then to make the problem worse, he then gets her husband, which was incidentally one of his most loyal followers, a best friend, and he plots and he puts her husband to death. This is a heinous crime, one of the most wicked sins you'll see recorded in all of Scripture. And God comes and confronts David. Now, you would think that when David looks at God and sees his own sin, that his instinct would be to run. He didn't, and nor should you. What David did is what you should do. Listen to the words of this prayer that David prayed when he was confronted with this heinous crime in his life. Psalm 51. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love. He's not running, he's repenting. Wash away all my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. Surely you desire truth from me in the inner parts. Cleanse me. You can feel the desire of David to find forgiveness from God. He's not running from God, he's running to him. Cleanse me with hyssop and I will be clean. Wash me and I will be whiter than snow. Create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit in me. This is a beautiful prayer, a prayer of confession. Do not cast me from your presence or take your Holy Spirit from me. If you don't know how to repent, if you do not know how to go to God and confess your sin, then just go to Psalm chapter 51 and read that psalm. Read it as a prayer to God and he will hear you. Do not run from God, run to him. Confess, repent, and he will put his arms around you. He will forgive. When you are with God, when you are a sinner, when you have fallen deep, when you are full of guilt and shame, I am telling you today, there is no better place to be than in the presence, in the throne room of God, as was Isaiah and as was David. I have a friend, he's one of these really good friends that you pick up in life as you go along. In fact, I studied with him helped to bring him to Jesus. More than that, when he got married to his fiancée, I was the pastor up the front who did the ceremony. Not long after I married him, in fact, they moved to another town. And that's where things started to go off the rails, because he fell off a cliff while he was at work. It was a very serious accident. He hurt his shoulder, he hurt his neck, and he's in pain to this day. And to control the pain, he went on to drugs. Now, they were prescription drugs, but it was a problem. Not only did he go on to drugs, but he started, and I could hardly believe the story when he told it to me, to sink with his wife into sexual immorality that I had never seen from anyone that I'd ever been or worked with. He told me that they got into wife swapping parties. He talked to me about what they would do, and it was serious R-rated demonic stuff. But you know, you can't go too far from God that He cannot reach you. There's nothing you can do that will turn God off wanting you back as His son and daughter. And God came to my friend, and my friend and his wife, and it is the most amazing story. Here they are wife swapping into sexual immorality and debauchery that, as I said, I'd never heard of, and yet God came to them and they responded. And rather than run, just as David did and just as Isaiah did, he stood before God and he confessed. Now, the confession that my friend and his wife went through was very, very important. But it's what God did when they confessed, which is the good news of this subject today. Remember Isaiah? Remember David? Remember my friend? They come to God, they're full of guilt, they're full of shame, they're full of sin, they're full of filth. Their instinct when they look at God in all His purity is to run, but they don't. They stand before Him like you've got to. And they confess their sins like you've got to. Isaiah chapter 6 and verse 5. And here's the response as they stand before God. "Woe, woe, woe to me," I cried. "I am ruined, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips. And my eyes have seen the King, the Lord Almighty." But look what happens. Verse 6. "One of the seraphs, one of the angels, flew to me with a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with tongs from the altar. With it he touched my mouth and said, 'See, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away and your sin atoned for.'" This live coal taken from the altar in the throne room of God represents God's forgiveness for Isaiah. It represents God's forgiveness for David. It represents God's forgiveness for my friend, and it represents God's forgiveness if you will stand before Him, if you will confess your sins. It represents God's forgiveness for you. God doesn't just accept and listen to your confession. God, and it is a beautiful thing, God forgives you. He forgives you. And I love this, verse 8. "Then I heard a voice of the Lord saying, 'Whom shall I send and who will go for us?' And I said," Isaiah says, "'Here am I, send me.'" Once God forgives you, once you've been through this experience, you know what it's like to live in the darkness and the sin and the shame, the guilt and the filth. And then all of a sudden, God comes into your life and He forgives you and He renews you and He makes you pure again. I tell you, you go through that experience. There's nothing you won't do for God. Isaiah became one of the greatest prophets in all of the Bible after his experience in this chapter. My friend who was into wife swapping, who was into sexual immorality, of the deepest kind. My friend now who has experienced this forgiveness from God, who has been into the throne room and has been touched by the live, fiery coal of forgiveness. There's nothing my friend won't do for Jesus. He's on fire. And I'm telling you today that when you go through this experience, when you find forgiveness with God, there'll be nothing that you won't do for Jesus either. I pray. Coming to you from the Crocodile Territory of Northern Queensland, I pray that this will be your experience too, as you find forgiveness in your Lord, in your Saviour, Jesus Christ.